opportunistic infection, multiple, sometimes severe opportunistic infection. And not only one member of the family. What we see in our clinic, usually infection starting with father, maybe through sexual or IDU, and he will transmit it to his wife. And if his wife become pregnant, there is a chance around 35% it also infected to their children. And that's why we are try to make a prevention, especially young people should know about mode of transmission of HIV so they can prevent it, they try to avoid HIV to enter their body. In Jakarta and other big city in Indonesia, most of our problem are in use, especially is intravenous drug users. In our clinic, new cases now 70% among IDU or intravenous drug users. Slide. Yeah, I just want to see you the opportunistic infection in our clinic. Mostly is TB, and the TB in HIV also one of the most prevalent cause of death in our clinic. And also, beside that, diarrhea, long time diarrhea, 1 month, 2 months, or 3 months diarrhea. And also, a disease called toxoplasma in the brain. Slide. This is toxoplasma in the brain, and you will see multiple abscess. Yeah, that is the abscess, a small abscess. Abscess, you know, very painful. If you have abscess in your hand, it will be very pain, and you can imagine how abscess in our brain, so the very headache, sometimes with vomiting, and sometimes person could be unconscious because of this infection. And it's very common among our ASEAN patients. Slide. Diarrhea, frequent also in our country and in the regions with many of the causes. So that's why people living with HIV, with CD4, low CD4, must be careful to with their food, not contaminated with parasite or bacteria. Right? And this is also the common disease in our regions. That is actually a fungi that attack our brain and make our neck very stiff. And fortunately, we have a medicine for this, and if it's diagnosed, then we could be cured. Slide. So, if people living with HIV have opportunistic infections, opportunistic infection should be treated because opportunistic infection is the cause of death. If we success with treatment of opportunistic infection, the people will recover and maybe he can walk again. But if we don't give antiretroviral treatment, which could stop the multiply of the viral, the opportunistic infection will relapse again. So, in 1996, combination of at least 3 combination of antiretroviral was founded, and is very active in reduce the multiply of the viral, and natural history of HIV changed since the founding of the antiretroviral treatment. We are very lucky in the region because most of our governments provided free antiretroviral to their people. Right? How the antiretroviral works? There are set of actions. You will see from the the action inhibit the fusion of the viral with the wall of lymphocyte. We call it fusion inhibitor. The other one is there is an enzyme called reverse transcriptase who will facilitate the change of RNA to DNA, and inhibitor of this enzyme also will influence the multiply of the virus, so the new viral will not occur. And the other side, at the right one, near the scissors, after multiply, by using the DNA materials in the nucleus of the lymphocyte, there is a long protein, and there is an enzyme called protease who will make the long protein to a short one, and this short protein will be a material for new HIV viral. Protease inhibitor, so the inhibit for this enzyme also is one of the drug that could be inhibit the new HIV. So you will see there are at least three sites at the fusion site, at the enzyme between the RNA to DNA, and at the protease. Okay, what is the advantage of this treatment? Goal of HIV treatment is to prolong and improve quality of life. Second one, there will be a reduced viral load. The number of viral will decrease. And in most of the cases, if you use this antiretroviral regularly, consistently, 6 months, most of our people living with HIV, if we test the viral load is become undetectable. What does it mean? That our machine cannot recognize the HIV anymore because the number is very, very small, usually below 50 copy. At the beginning, maybe 100,000 or 200,000, but by using antiretroviral, they could be undetectable. Because the number of viral is very, very small, it means that CD4 destruction is not anymore. So we will have CD4 increase. And in the perspective of transmissions, also people with viral load undetectable risk to transmit it to other people less than who has the viral load 100,000 or 200,000. Right? But in many countries in ASEAN, there are still problems, especially in the rural area. We should increase competency of our physician, nurses, and other health personnel. A laboratory and other support diagnosis tools are still limited. Also, some drugs for opportunistic infection is not available in many countries because expensive. That's why in some area, including in my country, in Indonesia, in hospital, still there is high mortality rate. But if we could diagnose HIV infection in early stage, at the clinical latency, we will avoid the opportunistic infection, the mortality rate will down. Slide. So antiretroviral treatment is very good drugs that can make the viral load undetectable, but please remember that we should use this antiretroviral long life, adherence, and that's why before we are starting the treatment, we should check that our health personnel already trained for that. Antiretroviral availability sustained, and person living with HIV should have a correct information, because if they use it in 1 year and he or she become well, maybe he or she will stop the antiretroviral because he or she thinks that he already cured. What happened if person living with HIV stop their antiretroviral? If they stop it around 2 months, the HIV, which is already undetectable, will increase again, and the number will be the same as the before the treatment. So adherence, it means that the compliance of people living with HIV to use it every day should be very important. That's why family or friends should support him or her to use this antiretroviral regularly, consistently, at the right doses. Slide. This very important slide showing that if adherence high, at the left side 95%, the viral suppression could be around 80. But what happened if adherence down to 90? The viral suppression will be only 65. How about 80? That one, yes. See, 80% of adherence, the viral suppression is only 50%. So that's why we should support people living with HIV to take their antiretroviral with adherence 95%. What does it mean? 95%, if they use it 30 days, it means it's only allowed to be lost 1 day. It's very, very difficult, because if you take the medicine, whether antibiotic or any medicine, usually we will forget it. So to make it not failure of viral suppression, adherence is very important. Right? So we are now in the era of antiretroviral. What does it mean? WHO stated that AIDS is not a fatal disease anymore, but AIDS now already become controlled chronic disease. Right? How about the side effect of antiretroviral? Fortunately, mostly mild and tolerable, like allergy or anemia or nausea, but most of the people living with HIV could tolerate the antiretroviral. Slide. Now coming to HIV infection and use. Mrs. Wong already mentioned that information of HIV among youth is very important. Not only information, but lifestyle. Healthy behavior among lifestyle, among youth is very important. And service of voluntary counseling and testing should be everywhere. So everybody who want to know about their status as HIV could access the service. If it's negative, they are very lucky, but if positive, access to treatment should be everywhere. And please remember that people living with HIV could recover again, could productive again, so access to study and work should be there. Who needs HIV test? Of course, if someone feel that they have a risky behavior, like unsafe sexual relation or sharing needle, especially during intravenous drug users, should have their test. But everybody who want to know HIV status also welcome to use the testing, HIV testing. Slide. Number of infected persons in many countries are high. So what is the future of them? Actually, if someone diagnosed and treated well, the future of HIV infected person is same as non-infected persons. Maybe with a little bit some limitations, like HIV infected person not allowed to donate their blood and organ. But how about marriage? They could marry, they could have children, and they could study and work as others, right? So, as summary, we already discussed HIV infection is important health problem in our regions, especially also among youth. So, knowing the mode of transmission is very important because prevention is important measure. Treatment of HIV antiretroviral changes the natural history of infections. People infected with HIV not necessarily will die, they could survive now. And access to information, diagnosis, and treatment among youth is very important. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Samsul Rizal. Okay, dear participants, now we come to the discussion sessions. May I remind you that after these sessions, we will have sessions on current situation of HIV and AIDS, and then we have another sessions on HIV and AIDS prevention. We have another three sessions relating with prevention. And then we have session on psychological impact, economic and psychological impact of HIV and AIDS, and another perspective and issues. So let us now focus on the natural history of HIV and AIDS, because another issues will be covered in another sessions. Okay, now let me invite maybe some questions from our colleagues and students from Hasanuddin University. Hasanuddin University, can you hear us? Is there any questions from your side?
Okay. I have a question. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thanks for the time. First, I'm very happy to know and asking for the person who almost full-time research this matter, this is Professor. Good morning, Professor.
Morning.
I have two questions. First, my question may be a little out. How a prof opinion about the herbal and alternative treatment with AIDS? The next question, how to make the price of the cheaper AIDS drugs. Thank you.
Please, Professor Samsurizal.
Thank you. So we have already for opportunistic infections the evidence-based drugs which is used. Some of them are very cheap, although some are expensive. But opportunistic infection is a common infection among us without HIV, so like diarrhea or TB is already approved drug which is already evidence-based. It means that the efficacy is already proved. But herbal and alternative has a place for symptomatics, like to increase our appetite or for sleep, but to stop the multiply of the HIV, we already have antiretroviral, which is approved to be effective. So herbal and alternative is complementary to the approval, to approve of the drug already approved to HIV or opportunistic infection. So it's complementary, not alternative. So you don't stop the antiretroviral and using herbal or alternative medicine. How about the price? Yeah, we are very fortunate that WHO and many countries now have a program Access for All. What does it mean that people who need antiretroviral hopefully will could access the antiretroviral because Access for All, the price should be very, very cheap. And there are many countries who have also produced, like Indonesia also produced the antiretroviral by locally, so the price will be very cheap. But of course, still there is budget for this, and we hope that many ASEAN governments will committed to the Access for All. It means that they will put the budget in the national budget.
Okay, is that clear, Hasanuddin? Okay, now let's proceed to another side. Let me invite questions maybe from Udayana University. Udayana University, are you hear me? Is there any questions? Any questions from Udayana? Yes, please. Udayana, can you hear me? No questions? Okay, now let's move to another side. If
yes.
There is
there are okay. Any questions from Udayana.
Okay, please, Udayana.
Thank you for the time. I'd like to ask Professor Zubairi about the if a positive HIV positive individual stop their treatment for a while, let's say for a month, because the access is difficult, and they want to continue their treatment after 1 month. Is there any evidence that prove that their treatment will be a success or something or unsuccess? Thank you.
This is from which side are you? Can you introduce yourself from which side?
Udayana University.
Udayana University. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Now, Professor Samsudizal, please.
So the question is about how if someone stop their treatment for 1 month, is the efficacy is still high? We already mentioned that adherence is very important, but in the field, we know that someone maybe stop their treatment because of some reasons, they don't like it, or they are boring, or sometimes because of the availability of the antiretroviral. So if they start it again, the risk of resistance is there, but it doesn't mean that they will not efficacy anymore. Still, maybe still efficacy, but the risk of resistance maybe arise. Fortunately, in Jakarta, we just make a survey about resistance on RV that newly diagnosed HIV, which is not yet treated by antiretroviral, the resistance to antiretroviral, first line antiretroviral, is still low, below 5%. It's been that the until now the problem of resistance in our country is not a big as big as the developed countries, but if we don't take this antiretroviral regularly, consistently, the, like another country, like developed country, the resistant problem will arise. So you can maybe you can talk with the someone who stopped their medicine. You should discuss the problem with the physicians, and the physician maybe will start it again if there is no another choice, or maybe they will change it to another antiretroviral if there is alternative for that.
Okay. Okay. I hope it's quite clear. Okay, now let me invite maybe one question.
Hello.
Let me invite the questions from UI side, Salimba. Salimba, can you hear me? Any question from Salimba?
Hello. Yes, Taufik from UI Salimba.
Yes, please.
Good morning, Prof. Samsu. My name is Taufik. Came from Public Health Faculty of University of Indonesia. The question is, if you don't mind, I have a lot of questions. First, in the slide of your presentation, you present that adherence and success of treatment. The question is the source of data about adherence and success of treatment, what factor contribute to the success of treatment? Is only adherence or there is another factor? That is the first question. Because I've got client in the field. He is 5 years old and has already 4 years consumption ARV, and then the viral load still got increase, and but the adherence is always his mother is always give ARV for this child, but last week the test VL make increase viral load. This is the first question. The second one is, had you heard about the side effect of ARV antiretroviral for depression? I heard about there is someone that had depression because using consumption ARV for a long time, not for every man, every woman that use ARV, but for a certain man. So had you heard about depression effect of ARV? Thank you, Prof. Samsu.
Thank you for a question. Adherence is very important, and that's why we should maintain the adherence. But besides adherence, treatment failure could also occur caused by other factors. Like you mentioned about the child, 5 years old, the dose. The right dose is very important in children, because in adults it's very easy. You can take 2 tablets a day or 1 tablet a day, But in children, the dose is considered by the body weight or many other measures. So the dose is very important. The other one also resistance. So maybe after using that 4 years, 5 years, adherence, but the system should also occur even in adherence people. And adherence is resistance is increased because if you use it a long time, the resistance will increase. So maybe after 5 years, 4 years, sometime 1 year already, resistance already occur. So first, we must make sure that our client is adherent. If the adherence, treatment failures still could occur, and we should check other factors. Yes, depression could have sometimes the side effect of antiretroviral called efavirenz. So efavirenz could make you drowsy, could make you sometimes headache, and some people who use efavirenz also could have some depressions. If it's usually it happen in the beginning of the treatment, but after by the time sometimes it disappear, but if it not disappear, maybe we should change the efavirenz to another antiretroviral.
Okay, I hope it's clear enough already for the questions. Okay, now let me invite colleagues and students from University of Erlangga. Can you see us already now? Is there any questions from Surabaya?
Yes, we have.
Yes,
yes, we have.
Okay, you have questions. Okay, please.
Yeah, I have just one question maybe for Prof. Samsurizal. It's about the slide from Prof. Samsurizal about era of IRC, I think. You mentioned before that this time in the era of IRC, it's not already become controlled chronic disease. Yeah. Yeah. In your slide about era of IRC, you mentioned that it's already become controlled chronic disease. Maybe Prof. Samsu can explain deeply. As we know that in our country, HIV tend to increase, not for I think increase in Papua, East Java, and another region. I mean, my question is, what is mean by control chronic disease if it's still increase in our country? Thank you for the time.
Thank you. We are using that term for outcome of the treatment. So before era of antiretroviral, most of the AIDS cases will die because of opportunistic infection. But after antiretroviral era, the morbidity is mean that admission to hospital or mortality is decreased. It mean that the chance to survive from AIDS situation is now big in era of antiretroviral. But the problem in Indonesia and maybe also in another ASEAN countries, we diagnose HIV infection at the late stage. It's already with opportunistic infection. If we could offer the testing for asymptomatic person without opportunistic infection and if we could detect that at the early of their infection, the chance to be survived is very, very high with antiretroviral. So this term is just to mention, formally it is considered to be a fatal disease. Everybody with it will die, but now it could be controlled. It means that they can live normally, although HIV is still in their body. So the term is not for the term of control the disease as the whole, because it's to control the disease, prevention is very important.
Okay. Now,
Hello, Bu Agustin. We have two questions anymore. Is it possible?
Maybe I should move to another side to give opportunity also to the other side. Later on, I will return back to University of Erlangga. Okay?
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Okay, now let me invite maybe some questions from our colleague, maybe from Bangkok, or KU, or Malaysia. Maybe if there are any questions, can you, or will you give some signs? If there is any questions from our colleague from Bangkok, from KU, and from Malaysia? Okay, if there is no question, let us move to another site in Indonesia also, to University of North Sumatra. Is there a question from Medan, University of Sumatra? Usu? No question? Any question?
Yes, we have questions and one question.
Okay, okay, one question, please.
Okay, thank you for the chance. I'm from University of North Sumatra. HIV can be detected live in our body after 5 years, and that means that our immune system has been so weak because of the destruction of the body. Right? Can you, ma'am?
Sorry, we cannot hear you clearly. Can you repeat your question, please?
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. HIV can be detected live in our body after 5 years, and that means that our immunity system had been so weak because of the destruction of lymphocytes. But the detection is done in clinically latency, and it is based on the HIV test, but there is no symptom on that stage. The symptoms are given on the previous stage in primary infection, like fever and influenza, but both of them are the general response of our body. So my first question is, what is the specific of fever and influenza are caused by HIV? Thank you. And the second question comes from my friend.
Okay, the second question, Lil X. What is amphotericin B and ganciclovir? Are they kinds of ARV? And the third, I've ever heard that vitamin C can help maintain our immune system in well condition or even increase our immunity. I want to ask, can vitamin C contribute in HIV treatment by maybe increasing the CD4? Thank you.
Okay. I'm sorry if I'm not so clear about the test. So we could detect HIV not 5 years. We could detect HIV if it's using the serology. There's a common test for HIV. It's around 3 months, because the window period is 3 months. If the HIV enter our body with the common test, we call it serology test, in 3 months it's already positive. But if you want to know earlier than 3 months, we can also detect HIV by detecting the viral itself. In 4 weeks, you already could detect that. 5 months or 8 years is the clinical symptoms appear. So 5 years or 8 years, we call it sometime incubation period, but not for testing. Testing, you can do it earlier by serology, because serology you measure the antibody is in 3 months, you already detected it. But virology, by examination the viral itself, by 4 weeks you already could detect that. So how we suspect that someone is maybe risky for HIV without any clinical symptoms? It's because we try to detect it by history of risky behavior. So if someone has history of using sharing needle when they are injecting drug user, that is 1 point, or maybe unsafe sexual relation, maybe the another point, or actually everybody who want to know their status, now we open the chance to be tested. So don't be worried. If you want to be tested, it's easy and it could detect early without symptoms, not waiting for 5 years. The second question, I mentioned about some medicine which is maybe not very popular, that is dalcyclovir and amphotericin B. That is not antiretroviral. That is not antiretroviral. That's the medicine for opportunistic infections. Ganciclovir is for cytomegalovirus infection. This is very common among people with HIV with CD4 less than 50. And amphotericin B is a drug for fungal infections. So it's not antiretroviral. The last question, I cannot hear that, about the immunity. I'm sorry.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. What is your last question?
Yes. I have heard that vitamin C can help maintain our cell condition.
Sorry, what is that?
Can you?
That vitamin C.
Okay, thank you.
That vitamin C can help maintain our immune system in well condition, or maybe can increase our immunity. Can vitamin C contribute in HIV treatment, or maybe can increase the CD4? Thank you.
Yeah, a lot of things could increase our body system. If you sleep well, your body system is increased. If you have a sport, your body system also increase. If you have a opportunistic mind, your immune system will also increase. But in HIV, CD4 is down, very low, and it only could be increased again by antiretroviral. Vitamin C or vitamin A or sleep well, nutrition, everything could contribute to the increase of our immune system, but we in HIV infection need antiretroviral. So you can change antiretroviral with just vitamin C.
Okay, I think it's already clear enough for students at the USU. Okay, before we turn back to the University of Erlangga, let me invite colleague and student from University of Diponegoro, Semarang, do you have any question, Semarang? No question? From Diponegoro. Okay, now let's go to Surabaya again. I invite colleagues and students from the University of Erlangga, please proceed to the next questions. You still have 40 questions. Erlangga University?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, please.
I have one question. The ARV treatment has to be given continuously without interruption. However, if there is any situation that make the treatment is stopped, how to overcome it? Thank you.
Maybe another question from Erlangga before Professor Samsurijal answer that question.
That's enough.
That's enough. Thank you.
That's enough. Okay. Please.
Yeah. If someone stop the antiretroviral, they should start it again and soon. So don't wait too long for starting. I understand that adherence is not only depend on person living with HIV, it's also depend on provider. It also depend of manager who have a duty to provide antiretroviral sustainability in the country. So sometimes it happened that people cannot use this because availability of the medicine is stopped, it's not there. So when the drug is available, start it as soon as possible. Yes, there is a risk of resistance, but we can follow whether resistance is occurred or not by evaluation of clinical symptom, by evaluation of CD4, and by evaluation of viral load. So, if someone stop antiretroviral with any reason, they could start it again as soon as possible.
Okay, thank you, Professor Samsurijal. Now, the last but not least site, students from UI site Depok. Please, any questions from Depok? Depok, please.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes. Okay.
I'm Dr. Rasef from Faculty of Public Health, University of Indonesia, one Afghan student. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, you can proceed with your questions.
Okay. Thank you, Professor, for your nice and comprehensive lecture. I have just one question that about the protective mechanism of HIV virus. Our body can get another viruses like retrovirus and influenza viruses, but our body resolve these viruses. What is the protective portion or protective characteristics of HIV virus that our body cannot resolve this virus?
Yeah, HIV viral is very unique. It's a retroviral, and also has the capacity to mutate easily, mutations. So it depends how the multiplication of HIV and our body response, whether it could be multiplication is more than our body response, so it will grow and grow again. And also, the viral has complicated medical term, escape from our immunity. So actually, as I show you that when the peak of number of the HIV is already there, it's become down again, a lot of the viral destroyed by our immune systems, but we cannot make it eradicate in our body. So it's still there, and by the time, especially at the state, at the late state of the disease, there will be increase again. So there are some mechanism, we call it escape mechanism from the HIV where our body system cannot eradicate it. But I don't want to discuss it more deeply because most of our audience are not in the background of biology or medicine.
Okay, now it's already 30 minutes past 11. Actually, this session is scheduled to be ended at 11 o'clock. We already 30 minutes more than that. It's very sorry that we have to finish the sessions, but will you please show the okay, I believe that all the participants from all sides, you still have many questions relating with this issue. You can send your question to this address, to this homepage, www.cml.ui.ac.id. We will try our best to answer your questions, and all questions relating with Professor Samsudijal's session will be also sent to Professor Samsudijal to have the most appropriate answer of these questions. I'm very sorry that we have to finish our session. It's very, very interesting to have this session, but the time is very limited for us. And another thing is, don't forget to submit your evaluation of today's session. Please come to this homepage, www.clr.ui.ac.id/gdlc/news. You can download the daily evaluation sheet, and then please send to us and let us know your opinion about today's session. Oh, sorry, it's online evaluation. So directly when you fill in the evaluation sheet, and then we will receive your evaluation. Okay, Professor Samsudijal, it's very pleasure, very nice to have your presentation today. We are very thankful to your time and your availability to meet with all the participants in all sides. And we hope that you will still give some more times if there are some questions from the participants. Okay, dear participants from all sides in Indonesia and from Bangkok, from Japan, KU, from Malaysia, I'm not sure, maybe there are some from Philippines and Timor Leste. Here we come to the end of the session today. We are very happy to meet you today. Don't forget to come and join the session in next week. Next week we have another two sessions dealing with current situation of HIV and AIDS. We have two sessions. The first one will be this discussing about HIV and AIDS global situation. And the second one is HIV and AIDS epidemic dynamic in the Asia region. So please come again next week and see you again next week at the same time. Bye-bye. Thank you very much.
Session untuk ikut ujian. Ya, terima kasih banyak. Nanti jumpa minggu depan. Terima kasih.
There's a three.
Sampai dengan jam 12. Di ini aja, Pak. Selamat di off aja. Masih ada yang hal-hal yang ingin didiskusikan di offline session? Kita sudah tidak all.
Selamat, sesi udah selesai, mungkin udah bisa ditutup sesi conference.
Juga boleh sekarang kan informasi sudah gampang diakses, mungkin ada yang lebih tahu dari saya, bisa silahkan.
Nama saya Rina, saya dari Atma Jaya. Mungkin perlu saya merasa bahwa perlu didiskusikan sedikit yang dipresentasikan oleh Prof. Samsu tadi mengenai stages of infection. Tadi disebutkan oleh Prof. Samsu ada primary infection, clinical latency, AIDS, dan death. Tadi sempat ngobrol-ngobrol dengan beberapa kawan. Apakah pertama stagesnya sudah berubah? Kalau yang dulu dipelajari AIDS itu adalah stage yang terakhir.
Oh.
Iya. Tetapi di sini death. Nah, dan yang sedikit tertinggal mungkin apa sih stadium ketiga? Stadium pertama yang window period dan stadium ketiga yang mulai gejala itu ya. Nah, tadi ini sih sebenarnya diskusi aja,
iya, dok.
Tadi sempat menyimak pertanyaan-pertanyaan dari beberapa kawan di universitas lain. Nah, seperti dari Sumatera Utara tadi yang tampaknya juga masih apa ya membutuhkan banyak informasi dasar tentang HIV. Saya agak khawatir kalau misalnya death disebutkan di sini mungkin akan membuat persepsi yang berbeda tentang HIV ini. Terima kasih.
Iya, iya, makasih, nanti bisa diklarifikasi dengan Prof. Samsu Rizal. Tapi begini, memang untuk stages ada berbagai versi gitu ya. Setahu saya yang tadi dipresentasikan itu bukan versi untuk medis. Mungkin ini dipermudah karena peserta di video conference ini kan nggak semua latar belakangnya medis. Ada yang non medis, sehingga Prof. Samsu Rizal menyederhanakan kepada stages yang lebih mudah dimengerti. Tapi itu memang ada beberapa versi. Tapi ini kita akan klarifikasikan lagi ke Prof. Samsu Rizal supaya ada kejelasan di antara para pesertanya. Masih ada yang lain? Silakan kalau ada. Kalau mau antar peserta juga boleh ya. Kalau ada yang mau nambahin informasi, kan mungkin dari peserta ada yang punya banyak pengalaman. Pak Taufik banyak pengalaman, saya tahu. Ya, bisa ditambahkan, silahkan gitu kan. Bukan saya yang paling tahu di sini.
Selamat siang, dok. Nama saya Supartono, dok, dari Atma Jaya. Saya menanyakan yang soal pada saat clinical latency kan jumlah virusnya turun.
Yeah.
Jadi kita bisa tes seseorang itu adalah HIV positif pada saat dia clinical latency adalah dari serologi, dok, atau dari viral juga bisa, dok. Itu yang pertama, dok. Yang terus yang kedua, itu tadi ada statement bahwa pasien yang sudah menjalani terapi ARV, mereka masih mereka bisa punya menikah dan punya anak. Apakah seseorang yang sedang menjalankan terapi itu sudah tidak bisa menginfeksi pasangannya, begitu? Mungkin terima kasih, dok.
Iya, ya begini. Pada fase latensi di mana jumlah viralnya turun dengan antibody, kita masih bisa deteksi pada tahap tertentu, pada kalau sudah terlalu rendah juga kita nggak bisa ininya. Kemudian kalau tadi, apakah kalau sudah ARV mereka boleh menikah? Masalahnya gini, menikah itu hak asasi gitu ya. Kita nggak bisa melarang orang untuk tidak menikah, kecuali di negara komunis. Kalau negara komunis begitu HIV positif bisa, mereka nggak boleh menikah gitu kan. Mereka nggak peduli hak asasi kan, kalau di negara komunis kepentingan masyarakat lebih penting gitu. Nah, apakah mereka masih bisa menularkan? Begini, kalau di kedokteran seperti Anda tahu kan, untuk penularan itu dibutuhkan viral load atau bacteria load tertentu kan, pada jumlah tertentu baru dia menularkan. Sehingga kalau itu bisa ditekan sampai rendah sekali, itu kemungkinan untuk menular itu jauh diperkecil. Bukannya nggak mungkin ya, karena pada seperti HIV kita nggak mungkin habis semua viralnya. Sampai sekarang belum ada antiretroviral yang bisa mengobati full gitu kan, sehingga yang bisa hanya ditekan gitu kan. Itu hanya mengurangi, meskipun cukup banyak, mengurangi kemungkinan untuk menginfeksi. Tapi kemungkinan itu tetap ada sih sebetulnya ya. Begitu, tapi itu jauh berkurang kalau dia dengan antiretroviral treatment. Ada lagi yang ini? Ada yang mau nambahin? Pak Taufik mau nambahin? Iya, silakan Pak Taufik.
Nanya bagus. Jadi banyak mungkin informasinya emang belum terlalu banyak gitu ke masyarakat. Kalau ODA itu bisa tetap punya keturunan yang negatif, karena emang faktanya di lapangan banyak teman-teman yang ODA yang ibunya positif, atau mungkin bapaknya aja yang positif, atau bahkan dua-duanya positif, bapak dan ibu, justru bisa punya anak yang negatif. Itu kenapa? Mungkin bisa dijelaskan dengan sangat simpel. Mereka bisa punya anak di saat tentunya dengan konsultasi dengan dokter, yang dokternya akhirnya approve untuk buka lepas kondom, sehingga mereka bisa memiliki keturunan. Jadi pada saat lepas kondom itu tentunya ada faktor-faktor yang dipikirkan oleh dokter. Mungkin jumlah virusnya yang tidak sudah mulai sedikit, terus jumlah CD4-nya sudah mulai tinggi, terus ada faktor-faktor lainnya juga mungkin. Terus pada saat buka kondom itu yang pasti pada saat si istri lagi masa subur. Jadi dihitung dia menstruasinya sampai hari H-nya dia masa subur baru lepas kondom. Jadi sebelumnya memang harus pakai kondom terus. Di banyak fakta di Amerika bahkan ada keluarga yang si ibunya positif HIV, anaknya empat ya Rine, yang di film itu. Dia lepas kondom cuma 5 kali, jadi cuma sekali dia gagal lepas kondom, tapi 4-4 yang dia lepas kondom jadi semua, dan semuanya anaknya negatif, padahal ibunya positif. Jadi banyak faktor, bahkan bisa orang tua yang positif dua-duanya bisa. Terima kasih.
Iya, makasih tambahnya Pak Taufik, itu sangat bermanfaat. Jadi kalau direncanakan bisa saja ya Pak Taufik ya, kalau direncanakan mau memiliki anak, karena seperti Prof. Samsur Rizal tadi katakan bahwa ARV sekarang sudah jauh lebih bagus daripada ARV dulu, sehingga kalau Prof. Samsur tadi sudah mengatakan bahwa sekarang HIV AIDS itu sudah dianggap sebagai penyakit kronis. Jadi itu sudah dianggap seperti gini, seperti hipertensi, diabetes. Orang tidak akan bisa sembuh dari hipertensi atau diabetes, tapi dia bisa hidup dengan hipertensi atau diabetes selama dia makan obat seumur hidup, selama itu terkontrol seumur hidup. Nampaknya HIV juga akan menjadi penyakit yang seperti itu gitu. Mungkin tidak akan bisa dihabiskan virusnya, tapi dia, orang akan bisa hidup bersama dengan virus HIV dengan cukup baik, seperti orang diabetes atau hipertensi bisa hidup cukup lama dan cukup baik selama dia, tadi seperti Prof. Samsu katakan, selama dia memang comply terhadap pengobatannya. Begitu. Ada lagi? Ada
Saya Alvina dari Atmajaya. Yeah, ingin bertanya sebenarnya tadi sama Prof. Samsu, cuman tadi mungkin kesempatannya tidak ada.
Bisa di itu ya nanti ya. Ya selain di sini nanti kamu juga bisa di posting nanti. Ya.
Mau didiskusikan di sini sebenarnya kan kalau yang aku tahu, misalkan sebagai tenaga kesehatan, misalkan kita kena scratch atau gimana dengan jarum yang terkontaminasi darah HIV, kita mesti lapor kalau nggak salah dalam waktu 3x24 jam. Kemudian setelah lapor itu, kita juga harus mengkonsumsi ARV itu dalam jangka waktu tertentu sampai kita dites dan dinyatakan negatif. Yang aku mau nanya, kalau misalkan virus itu udah ada misalnya di dalam tubuh kita, itu bisa nggak sih selama masa? Itu kan kita langsung tuh minum ARV, bisa nggak sih di-eliminate sampai viral load-nya tuh nol, jadi kita nggak usah konsumsi ARV lagi gitu? Atau ARV itu benar-benar cuma mensupresi viral load-nya aja? Makasih.
Kalau baru, jadi kalau di tenaga kesehatan, sebetulnya gini, yang penting sebetulnya adalah sebagai tenaga kesehatan, kita tidak boleh membedakan itu adalah pasien HIV atau tidak. Semua pasien harus dilayani dengan sama. Jadi sebetulnya juga tidak diperbolehkan tenaga kesehatan itu menanyakan pasiennya HIV positif atau enggak, sehingga ada perlakuan yang beda. Kalau HIV dia lebih hati-hati gitu, enggak boleh. Karena kita tahu sebetulnya sebagai tenaga kesehatan itu universal precaution, harus dilakukan sama terhadap semua pasien. Jadi dia harus berhati-hati supaya dia sendiri tidak terinfeksi. Sekarang masalahnya kalau terjadi seperti yang tadi Anda katakan seperti itu yang ada sekarang itu kan harus segera minum ARV. Ya ARV-nya apa saya nggak begitu paham, tapi kalau Prof. Samsu tahu apa yang harus diminum gitu kan. Nah, dengan itu diharapkan viral-nya belum sempat untuk bereplikasi di dalam tubuh, sehingga bisa eliminasi nol sama sekali, karena belum sampai ke taraf di mana dia bisa replikasi banyak. Makanya itu kan ada aturan harus sesegera mungkin, ada jamnya yang tadi kamu udah katakan. Nah, tapi apakah dia betul-betul negatif, tentu harus dibuktikan. Ada syarat-syaratnya, berapa kali tes, sampai berapa kali tes dia negatif terus, baru dia dibuktikan bahwa memang si tenaga kesehatan ini tidak tertular dan dia bisa lepas dari ARV, nggak harus minum ARV seumur hidup. Ada lagi? Tapi itu kita bicara kalau belum positif ya, tapi kalau sekali udah positif, itu harus ARV. Ada lagi?
Saya Fahri dari Atmajaya. Mau nanya, tadi disebutkan pemberian ASI itu bisa menurunkan HIV ke anak bayi. Padahal ASI itu kan asupan penting sekali untuk bayi gitu.
Iya.
Jadi bagaimana? Apakah harus di stop atau bagaimana gitu?
Ini pertanyaannya bagus, karena ini kontroversi di mana-mana. Gini, sebetulnya gini, kalau di daerah tersebut dan si orang tua tersebut bisa mendapatkan pengganti ASI dari orang tua yang HIV positif nih ya, bisa mendapatkan pengganti ASI dan bisa dibuat secara higienis, kebersihannya terjamin, terus takarannya juga pas, itu dianjurkan untuk tidak menggunakan ASI, karena ASI punya risiko untuk menularkan. Tapi pada keadaan di mana orang tua tidak bisa membeli ASI, pengganti ASI, tidak bisa membeli susu formula, jadi diencerkan atau penyiapannya tidak bisa higienis, itu masih disarankan lebih baik memberi ASI daripada si bayi itu nanti meninggal juga karena infeksi yang lain, gitu kan? Ya, itu memang kontroversi gitu ya. Memang ada dua pendapat. Jadi akhirnya seperti itu. Kalau bisa ya sudah diganti sama sekali. Kalau nggak bisa lebih baik ASI, karena nanti kalau nggak nanti bayinya akan tertular penyakit yang lain. Ya. Iya.
Mau menanggapi pertanyaan yang tadi dong.
Iya, silakan kalau kamu ada ininya.
Kebetulan pernah ikut semacam seminar singkat gitu
Iya.
di kampus itu tentang PMTCT, Prevention Mother to
Child Iya.
Transmission.
Kalau di sana disebutkan juga sebenarnya ibu itu bisa juga memberikan ASI eksklusif selama 2 bulan.
Iya. Yeah.
Dengan catatan tetap mengkonsumsi ARV.
Iya. Yeah.
Dan mungkin nah saya mungkin dari situ sudah 2 bulan baru ASI-nya mulai digantikan dengan makanan pengganti ASI atau susu formula lainnya gitu. Bagaimana pendapat dokter?
Iya, itu juga bisa ada berbagai macam pendapat sih tentang hal itu ya. Ya yang tadi Anda katakan juga bisa, tapi dengan syarat tadi ibunya meminum ARV dengan benar ya. Dia minum ARV terus sehingga viral load-nya bisa ditekan. Iya, silakan. Pak Tommy ini banyak ini nih. Meskipun bukan dokter, dia banyak pengalaman di lapangan.
Apa sebenarnya kan ada empat prinsip penularan HIV, ada exit, ada sufficient, ada survive, dan sama enter. Sebenarnya dalam susu ibu, air susu ibu itu sebenarnya nggak cukup virus untuk menularkan. Jadi yang perlu diingat di garis bawah di sini, penularan dari mother to child pada saat menyusui itu bukan karena susunya, bukan karena cairan susu, tapi karena si bayi itu suka nyedot puting ibunya dan kegigit luka, yang susu itu bukan susu, jadi susu dan darah. Jadi yang perlu diingat, susu ibu itu sufficient, tidak cukup jumlah virusnya. Jadi yang cukup itu adalah darah si ibu, dari puting susu si ibu, sehingga si bayi nyedot darah ibunya. Terima kasih.
Masih ada hal-hal yang ingin didiskusikan? Kalau ada pertanyaan tadi seperti sudah dikatakan, bisa diposting di website-nya tadi ya, yang sudah ada. Jadi silakan tuh nanti bisa dijawab langsung oleh para expertnya. Dan jangan lupa mengisi evaluasi hariannya. Nggak pakai nama, jadi terserah diisi menurut pendapat Anda sesi pagi ini berlangsungnya seperti apa. Masih ada pertanyaan-pertanyaan lagi? Oke, masih ada. Kalau masih?
Dok, silakan. Teknis sih dok. Nanyanya teknis ini, jadi kalau masuk ke yang tadi website yang ditujukan untuk pertanyaan-pertanyaan itu, yang harus kita kirim, ini mesti login dulu?
Nggak usah. Itu bisa langsung masuk. Tadi saya pagi udah coba di rumah, nggak dari UI gitu.
Oh.
Bisa. Saya jadi tadi nggak pakai akun UI, dari rumah bisa langsung diisi.
Makasih dok.
Iya. Yang itu bisa langsung diisi dari. Materinya juga bisa langsung di download. Tadi saya coba dari rumah bisa, tanpa koneksi UI. Ada lagi? Oke, kalau nggak ada, kita akhiri sesi pagi ini sampai di sini. Dan kita akan lanjutkan minggu depan pada tempat yang sama. Kalau mau lihat jadwalnya apa, bisa dilihat di websitenya. Topiknya apa yang akan diberikan minggu depan. Ya, terima kasih.
Kita nggak pernah lihat posternya dari dia. Kita cuma terima jadi. Tapi yang kan ini parah. Bang.
Punya dokter Irwanto yang session yang...